Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sweet Revenge by Andrea Penrose. Narrated by Mary Sarah. Sweet is revenge, especially to women. George Gordon Byron. Don Juan, Canto Number 1, Stanza 124. Chapter 1. From the Chocolate Notebooks of Dona Maria Castellano. How fascinating! I recently discovered an old Spanish missionary's journal in a Madrid bookstore and found a number of references to chocolate among his writings. According to him, ancient Aztec legend has it that the cacao tree was brought to earth by their god Quetzalcoatl, who descended from heaven on the beam of a morning star after stealing the precious plant from paradise. No wonder that the spicy beverage made from its beans was called the drink of the emperor. It is said that this chacotl, or chocolatl, was so revered that it was served in golden goblets that were thrown away after one use. The scent of burnt sugar swirled in the air, its sweetness melting with the darker spice of cacao and cinnamon. Candles flickered, the tiny tongues of flame licking out as the footman set the plate on the dining table.
Ah!
The gentleman leaned down and inhaled deeply, his fleshy face wreathing in a sybaritic smile.
Why, my dear Catherine, it smells good enough to eat.
Laughter greeted the bon mot. Oh, indeed it is, Poppet. I've had my chef create it specially for you. The heavily rouged lady by his side parted her lips, just enough to show a peak of teeth, and only you.
How delicious.
Plumes of pale smoke floated up toward the painted ceiling and slowly dissolved in the shadows. His lazy-lidded gaze slid past the glittering silver candelabra and took in the empty place settings of the other half-dozen guests.
And what, may I ask, is it?
Chocolate.
Chocolate, he echoed, sounding a little puzzled. But
edible chocolate, explained Catherine. A new innovation, fresh from Paris, where, as you know, the French have refined sumptuous indulgence to an art form in itself. She lowered her voice to a sultry murmur.
Aren't you tempted to try it?
All eyes fixed hungrily on the unusual confection. Soft mounds of chantilly cream ringed the porcelain plate, accentuating the dark, decadent richness of the thick wafers arranged at its centre. Ranging in hue from café au lait to burnished ebony, they rose up from a pool of port-soaked cherries.
I must warn you, though, she teased. Chocolate is said to stimulate the appetite for other pleasures. Her lashes fluttered.
But perhaps you are already sated after such a rich meal.
One can never have enough pleasure,
replied the gentleman, as he plucked the top piece from its buttery perch and popped it into his mouth. A collective sigh sounded from the others as he gave a blissful little moan, squeezed his eyes shut, and promptly pitched face first into sticky sweetness. There was a moment of dead silence, followed by a slow, slurping shudder that sent a spray of ruby red drops and pink-tinged cream over the pristine tablecloth.
Good God! Send for a physician! Screamed one of the guests. The Prince Regent has been poisoned!
Chapter 2. From the Chocolate Notebooks of Dona Maria Castellano. Chocolate was served during religious rites and celebrations. It was often mixed with such flavorings as vanilla, cinnamon, allspice, chilies, winicastelli, a spicy flower from the custard apple tree, and antiote, which turns the mouth a bright red. The Aztecs also believed that the dried beans of the cacao tree possess strong medicinal properties. Indeed, warriors were issued cacao wafers to fortify their strength for long marches and the rigors of battle, a fact that Sandro will undoubtedly find of great interest. I, too, have remarked on the nourishing benefits of hot, sweetened chocolate. Steam rose from the boiling water, enveloping the stove in a cloud of moist tropical heat.
Hell!
A hand shot out and shoved the kettle off the hob. Cleaning up after such a feast would likely take another few hours, thought the chef irritably. But that was the price, or was it penance, for choosing to work alone? A baleful glance lingered for a moment on the kitchen's work table, the dirty dishes and pots yet another reminder that the aristocratic asses upstairs were gluttons for decadent foods. More, always more. Their hunger seemed insatiable. But it wasn't as if their appetite for sumptuous pleasures came as any great surprise to Arianna Hadley. Contempt curled the corners of her mouth. Indeed, she had counted on it. Turning away from the puddles of melted butter and clotted cream, she wiped her hands and carefully collected the scraps of paper containing her recipes. The edges were yellowing, the spidery script had faded to the colour of weak tea, and yet she could not quite bring herself to copy them onto fresh sheets of foolscap. They were like old friends, her only friends, if truth be told. And together they had travelled, her hands clenched, crackling the papers. Not that she cared to dwell on the sordid details. They were, after all, too numerous to count. She closed her eyes for an instant. For as far back as she could remember, life had been one never-ending journey. Jamaica, St. Kitts, Barbados, Martinique, along with all the specks of Caribbean coral and rock too small to have a name. Foam-flecked, rum-drenched hellholes, awash in rutting pirates and saucy whores. And from there across the ocean to the glittering bastion of civilized society. Ah, yes. Here in London, the scurvy scum and sluts were swathed in fancy silks and elegant manners, fine-cut jewels and satin smiles, all thin veneers that hid a black-hearted core of corruption. Tracing a finger over a water-stained page, Arianna felt the faint grit of salt and wondered whether it was residue from the ocean voyage or one of the rare moments when she had allowed a weak-willed tear. Of late, she had disciplined herself to be tougher, harder. But as the steam wafted over the sticky pots, stirring a sudden, haunting hint of island spices, she blinked, and the words blurred, light and dark, spinning into a vortex of jumbled memories. Fire, smoke, the lush scent of sweetness licking up from the flames.
Breathe deeply, ma petite,
her voice lashed with the lilt of the tropics, the mulatto cook leaned closer to the copper cauldron.
Drink in its essence.
She sprinkled a grating of cinnamon, a pinch of anchovy, over the roasting nibs.
Watch carefully, Arianna. Like life itself, the cacao is even better with a bit of spice. But the mix must be just right. Let me show you.
Dark as ebony, Oribe's hands fluttered through the tendril of steam.
Theobroma cacao, food of the gods, she murmured. Now we must wait for just the right moment to douse the flames. Remember, its magic cannot be rushed.
From a smaller pot, the cook poured a measure of hot milk into a ceramic cup, adding a spoonful of ground beans, thickened with sugar. She whipped the concoction to a foaming froth with her molinillo.
But patience will be rewarded. Drink this.
Then the image of the old servant dissolved. And Arianna found herself staring into the shadows. Shadows. She remembered shifting shapes of menacing black and the rumblings of thunder from a fast-approaching storm. Dancing to the drumming of the wind against the shutters, a tendril of smoke had swirled up from the lone candle, casting a trail of twisted patterns over a blood-stained sheet.
Drink this, Papa.
She was holding a glass of cheap rum to her father's trembling lips. A physician will be here soon, with laudanum, to help ease the pain. She lied, knowing full well that not a soul would come rushing to help two penniless vagabonds.
I would rather have a sip of your special chocolate, my dear.
He tried to smile, despite the jagged knife wound gouged between his ribs.
So much blood. So much blood.
Cursing the stinking wharfside alleys and the shabby tavern room, she pressed a palm to the scarlet-soaked handkerchief, trying to staunch the flow.
I shall always savour the sweet memory of you.
He went on in a whisper.
A groan gurgled deep in his throat. Good in heaven,
Forgive me for being such a wretched parent, and for sinking you in such a sordid life. You are not to blame. You were falsely accused.
Yes, I was. I swear it, he rasped. But it doesn't matter. Not for me.
He coughed.
But you deserve better.
Never mind that. You deserve justice, Papa. Tell me who did this to you.
I.
But there was no answer. Only a spasm of his icy fingers. And then a silence louder than the wailing wind. Arianna shifted on her stool, recalled back to the present by the clatter of footsteps on the stairs. Her skin was sheened in sweat, and yet she was chilled to the bone.
Chef! Chef!
Fist pounded on the closed door.
Monsieur Alphonse! Open up! Something terrible has happened.
Smoothing at the ends of her false moustache, Arianna quickly tucked the papers into her smock and rose. Perhaps it was too late for justice. Perhaps all that mattered now was vengeance.
Indeed.
Lord Percival Grentham's expression remained impassive. A senior government minister in Whitehall's War Office, he was in charge of security for London, which included keeping watch over the royal family. And with the king lingering in the netherworld of madness and his grown children mired in one scandal after another, it was a task designed to test his legendary sang-froid. Grentham's assistant nervously cleared his throat.
But he's going to survive, my lord,
he added hastily.
A physician happened to be treating a patient next door and was summoned in time to purge the poison from the prince's stomach.
More's the pity,
snapped Grentham's military attaché, who was standing by a superior's desk, arranging the daily surveillance reports.
Bloody hell! If Prinny can't control his prodigious appetites, he could at least have the decency to fall victim in his own establishment.
The assistant didn't dare respond. Leaning back in his chair, Grentham tapped his elegant fingertips together and stared at the bank of windows overlooking the parade ground. Rain pelted against the misted glass, turning the vast expanse of gravel to a blur of watery grey. Beyond it, the bare trees in St. James's Park jutted up through the fog, dark and menacing, like the jagged teeth of some ancient dragon.
How long until he can be moved from Lady Spencer's townhouse?
He asked slowly. The assistant consulted the sheaf of papers in his hands.
Another 2 or 3 days.
Bloody, bloody hell,
swore the attaché.
If word of this reaches the newspapers, thank you, Major Crandall.
The tapping ceased, as did all of the sounds in the room. Turning to his assistant, Grentham continued with his inquiries.
I take it that the other guests have been sworn to absolute secrecy, Jenkins?
Yes, my lord. And they've all promised to be silent as the grave.
Excellent, he replied mildly. Oh, and do remind them that they had better be. Else their carcasses will be rotting on a transport ship bound for the Antipodes.
Yes, my lord.
The young man was new to the job, and hadn't yet dared ask what had become of his predecessor. Rumours of Grentham's ruthlessness were rife throughout the halls of the Horse Guards building, and it was whispered that even the Prime Minister feared to provoke his ire. Taking up his pen, Grentham jotted several lines on a fresh sheet of foolscap.
Do we know for certain what poison was used?
Not as yet, sir. The physician says it is difficult to discern, on account of the, substance that the prince ingested.
The young man paused, looking uncertain of whether to go on.
Well, do you intend to keep me in suspense all afternoon?
Asked Grentham softly.
Or is this meant to be an amusing little guessing game, seeing as I have nothing else to do with my time?
No, sir.
The assistant gave another glance at his notes.
It was chocolate.
Chocolate?
Repeated Crandall incredulously.
If this is your idea of a joke, Jenkins.
It's no joke, sir. It's the God honest truth.
Jenkins held out a piece of paper with a suspicious-looking stain streaked across its bottom.
You may see for yourself.
Grentham waved away the offending document with a flick of his wrist.
I am a trifle confused, Jenkins, he murmured. I thought you said Prinny ate the stuff, not drank it.
He did, sir. It says here in the physician's report that the Prince Regent collapsed after eating a disc of solid sweetened chocolate.
Seeking to forestall another acerbic attack, he quickly went on.
Apparently, The confection is a recent culinary creation developed in France. It is said to be very popular in Paris.
Shakuna songu,
said Grantham under his breath.
Sir? Never mind. Go on. Anything else of interest in the report? Well, milord, the man does mention the possibility that the prince might have sickened from overindulgence and not from any toxin.
Jenkins swallowed hard.
But the prince's private physician questions whether chocolate, in this new, solid form, might have naturally occurring poisonous properties.
Grantham thought for a moment.
So, in fact, we don't have a clue as to whether this was an attempt on the reigning sovereign's life, or merely another example of his appetite for pleasure getting him in trouble.
Looking unhappy, Jenkins nodded. His superior was known as a man who preferred to view the world in black and white. An infinite range of greys merely muddied the subject, which did not bode well for whoever presented the ill-formed picture.
I should be tempted to let him stew in his own juices, began the major.
But a sharp look from Grantham speared him to silence. The minister fingered one of the leather document cases piled on his desk.
Given the current situation, it is imperative. Imperative! That we ascertain whether foul play was involved. What with the upcoming arrival of the Allied delegation and our troubles with the upstart Americans, the death of the Prince Regent could be catastrophic for the interests of England.
The assistant instinctively backed into the shadows of the dark oak filing cabinets, though he had a feeling that the basilisk stare of his superior could see straight through to the deepest coal-black pit of hell.
And so, he mused, however unpleasant a task, we must extract the truth from this sticky mess.
Jenkins gave a sickly smile, unsure whether the minister had just attempted a witticism.
The question is, who among our operatives is best equipped to handle such an investigation?
Grantham pursed his lips.
Any suggestions?
The major quickly shot a look at Jenkins.
Well, my lord, I...
Spit it out, man! Ordered the major. We haven't got all day.
Sweat beaded on the assistant's brow, though his throat remained bone dry.
I was just going to say, perhaps one of our peninsular allies might prove you useful, seeing as it was the Spanish who brought cacao to Europe from the New World. It would seem logical that they would be the most knowledgeable on the subject.
Grantham looked thoughtful. The major's gaze narrowed to a crafty squint.
Yes. I was just going to say that I think it an excellent idea to look outside our own circle of intelligence officers, he said quickly. They are all personally acquainted with the prince, and we wouldn't want any question of impartiality to colour the conclusion of the investigation. I mean, sir, if anything were to...
He let his voice trail off. Grantham flashed a semblance of a smile.
Good God, I may actually have a body or two around me with a brain.
Setting down his pen, he contemplated his well-manicured hand for a bit, before slowly buffing his nails on his other sleeve. Swoosh, swoosh, swoosh. The sound was soft as a raptor's wing beat, homing in on its kill.
Send a messenger to Lord Charles Mellon. Tell him that I wish to see him. As soon as possible.
Arianna added a spoonful of sugar to her morning coffee and slathered a scone with butter. The condemned ought to eat a heartier meal, she thought sardonically as she broke off a morsel of the still-warm pastry and let it crumble between her fingers. If luck was indeed a lady, the traitorous bitch had a perverse sense of humour. Biting back a grim smile, Arianna had to admit the irony of the situation. After all her meticulous plotting and carefully calculated moves, one unfortunate little slip had wreaked havoc with her plans. The best-laid schemes of mice and men go often askew and leaves us nothing but grief and pain. Her father, who had carried a love of poetry and precious little else with him from England to Jamaica, had enjoyed reading Robert Burns to her on the rare evenings when he wasn't sunk too deep in his cups. Arianna had cherished those times together, curled in the comforting shelter of his arms. She sucked in her breath, her lungs suddenly filled with the memory of his scent, an earthy mix of tobacco, leather, and citrus-spiced sandalwood. Oh, Papa, she thought, expelling a slow sigh. So brilliant, yet so naive. Scandal had stripped him of all his rightful honour,
forcing him to survive on his wits. But even his enemies admitted that Richard Hadley, the Earl of Morse, was a charming dreamer. Like fine brandy, his mellifluous laugh was smoothly seductive, making even the most grandiose schemes seem plausible. The Earl was so convincing that over the years he had come to believe his own lies. Blood must run true, mused Arianna, for it seemed that she had inherited his gift for deception. Raising a defiant finger, she traced the burnt cork stippling that darkened her jaw. A short stint with a theatre troupe in Barbados had taught her the art of disguise. Paint and glue, false hair and feather padding. With the right touch, a skillful hand could alter one's appearance beyond recognition. It helped that most people were easy to fool. They saw only what they expected to see and rarely noticed what lay beneath the surface.
Mr. Alphonse!
The shout cut through the quiet of the kitchen.
Captain Mercer will see you. Now!
Oui, oui, I am coming, she called.
Thank God her voice was naturally husky. A slight roughening of the edges was all it required to mimic a masculine growl. Making no effort to hurry, Arianna paused to make one last check of her reflection in one of the hanging pots. She would have preferred to be interrogated here in the kitchen, where she was master of her own little underworld. The light was kept deliberately murky, while the crowded racks of cookware and herbs created added distraction. However, there was one thing she had learned over the years of fending for herself. It was how to improvise.
Step lively,
snapped the guard, punctuating the command with a rap of his pistol against the door. Though dressed as a footman, there was no mistaking his military bearing.
The likes of you ought not to keep your betters waiting,
she took her time mounting the stairs.
Bloody frog,
he muttered, shoving the gun barrel between her shoulder blades to hurry her up the last few treads. The guard escorted her into the breakfast room, where a big, beefy army officer sat perfectly centred on the far side of the dark mahogany table. All the other seating had been cleared away, save for a single straight-backed chair set directly opposite him. It looked rather forlorn in the wide stretch of empty space.
Sit down,
he barked. For an instant, Arianna debated whether to remain on her feet. Goading him to anger might distract him from his intended line of questioning, but she quickly decided against the strategy. However cleverly padded, her body was best not put on prominent display.
Mercy,
she mumbled, slouching down in her seat. It was only then that she noticed a second figure standing by the bank of mullioned windows. He too was dressed in scarlet regimentals, but the colour blended neatly into thick damask draperies of the same hue. The slanted shadows and angled sunlight made his features hard to discern. It was his carefully groomed side whiskers that caught her attention. Sparks seemed to dance through the ginger hair, as if it were on fire.
Well, what have you to say to defend yourself, Mr. Alphonse?
Went on the officer seated at the table, shifting her gaze to the papers piled in front of the pompous prig. Arianna replied with exaggerated surprise.
Am I being accused of something, mon général?
Oh, so you think yourself a clever little bastard, eh? To make light of an assassination attempt on the Prince Regent of England.
The captain, whose rank was clearly denoted by the stripes on his sleeve, thinned his lips.
I promise that you will soon comprehend it is no laughing matter.
No, it's not amusing, not in the least,
she agreed, deliberately drawing out her French accent.
It's grave, very grave.
The captain glared, uncertain as to whether he was being played for a fool. Snapping open a leather-bound ledger, he scanned over several pages of notes before speaking again.
I have sworn statements that you were the only one working in the kitchen the night the prince was poisoned. Is that true?
Ça dépend. That depends,
answered Arianna calmly.
The servants who carried the dishes up to the dining room were in and out all evening.
She paused.
I'm sure you have been told that the supper was a lengthy affair, with numerous courses.
Did you see anyone tampering with the food?
He asked quickly.
No.
Nor anyone lingering below stairs?
It was the officer by the window who asked the question.
No,
replied Arianna, not looking his way. While her first response had been the truth, this one was a lie. She had seen someone, but she had no intention of sharing that information with the Crown. Shoving back his chair, the captain rose abruptly,
setting off a jangle of metal. Arianna watched the flutter of ribbons and braid as the gaudy bits of gilded brass and enamelled silver stilled against his chest. Did the man have any notion how ridiculous he looked, strutting about in his peacock finery? His martial scowl was belied by the fleshiness of his hands as he braced them on the polished wood. They looked soft as dough. A bred soldier, thought Arianna. A staff flunky. Put him in a real fight, and a butter knife would cut through him in one swift slice. As for the other one, he looked to be made of sterner stuff. She guessed that he was the man in command.
Mr. Alphonse!
Raising his voice to a near shout, the captain leaned in and angled his chin to a menacing tilt.
Did you try to murder the Prince Regent?
Arianna ducked her head to hide a smile.
Conceited coxcomb. I've been bullied by far more intimidating men than you. If you answer me honestly, it will go a lot easier for you,
he went on.
Otherwise, future interrogations could become quite unpleasant.
His mouth twitched into a nasty smile.
For you, that is. I have told you the truth. I did not poison the prince,
she said.
If you don't believe me, why don't you search the kitchen?
The draperies stirred, echoing a low laugh.
What do you think my men are doing as we speak?
The officer there moved to stand in front of the windows. Limed in the morning light, his silhouette was not but a stark, dark shape against the panes of glass, save for the halo of ginger fire.
I have nothing to fear, she answered calmly.
The bag containing her disguises was well hidden beneath the pantry floorboard, with the weight and odour of the onion barrel discouraging too close an inspection of the dark corner.
I am innocent of any attack on your prince.
The captain replied with a vulgar oath.
Am I under arrest?
Asked Arianna, deciding it was to her advantage to end the interview as soon as possible. She had overheard two of the guards discussing their orders earlier, and was aware that Whitehall was sending another interrogator later in the day. She would save her strength for that confrontation.
Not yet, you stinking little piece of... Leave us for a moment, Captain Mercer.
The other officer cut off his cohort with a clipped command. The captain snapped a salute.
Have a pleasant chat with the Major, Froggy,
he muttered under his breath. The Major's boots clicked over the parquet floor, echoing the sound of the door falling shut. Approaching the captain's vacated chair, he picked up a penknife from the table and slowly began cleaning his nails. Snick, snick, snick. The faint scrapings were meant to put her on edge, thought Arianna, as she watched the flash of slivered steel. Like her, the Major understood the importance of theatrics. The noise ceased. Bowing her head, she remained silent.
I think you are lying to us, Mr. Alphonse,
he said in a deceptively mild tone. She lifted her shoulders in a Gallic shrug.
What can I say? It's hard to offer proof for an act that I haven't committed. Oh, I don't expect you to speak right now. I am perfectly happy to let you stew a little longer about your fate.
He stroked at his side whiskers, and his fingers came away with a trace of macassar oil on their tips.
You see, I expect you to die. But if you give us the information we want, the process will be a good deal less painful for you.
Arianna kept her expression impassive.
What's the matter? Cat got your tongue? Arguing with you would only be a waste of breath, she murmured. Am I excused? The household expects to eat at noon. Go.
He placed the blade atop the captain's sheaf of notes.
But be assured, you haven't heard the last from me.
Chapter 3. From the Chocolate Notebooks of Dona Maria Castellano. The cacao tree was a symbol not only of health, but of wealth. A prized commodity, the beans were used as currency by Aztecs. The missionary mentioned seeing a local document that listed some of the trading values. A tomato cost one cacao bean, an avocado cost 3 beans. And a turkey hen cost 100 beans. The next few pages of his journal show some sketches of various drinking vessels for cacao. Oh, how I should like to find one of the ceremonial cups made from a hollow gourd that were used to serve the army, its elixir.
It would make a special gift for Sandro, and perhaps keep him safe.
Thank you for coming to see me, Lord Saybrook,
Grantham didn't look up from the document he was reading.
I trust that the request did not inconvenience you.
Without waiting for an invitation, Alessandro Henry George de Quincey, the 5th Earl of Saybrook, shifted his cane and sat down in the chair facing the desk.
Not at all. I am always at the beck and call of the government.
Grantham dipped his pen in ink and wrote a lengthy notation in the paper's margin before setting his work aside.
How kind.
Narrowing his gunmetal grey eyes, he subjected Saybrook to a lengthy scrutiny. The Earl stared back, seemingly unconcerned that he looked like he had just crawled out of the deepest, darkest corner of hell. His long black hair was neatly combed, and his face freshly shaven. But no brush or razor could disguise the ravages that pain and narcotics had wrought on his body. Sallow skin stretched over bone sharp as sabers. Bruised shadows accentuated his hollow cheeks, and his clothes hung loosely on his lanky frame. Grantham, on the other hand, was immaculately attired in a charcoal coat of superfine wool, which set off the starch folds of his snowy cravat to perfection.
But now that we have met,
the minister went on,
I cannot help but wonder whether your trip here was a waste of both your time and mine. My uncle has explained the task at hand, replied Saybrook,
matching the other man's sardonic tone.
If I did not feel myself up to its rigors, I should not have bothered coming here.
After allowing a fraction of a pause, he added,
one of the first lessons I learned as an army intelligence officer was that appearances can often be deceiving.
Grantham's nostrils flared for an instant, but he covered his displeasure with a bland smile.
So, you think that you are capable of rising to the occasion, Lord Saybrook?
Again the gunmetal gaze raked over the Earl's legs.
Despite your infirmity? I assure you, sir, my infirmity does not affect my performance.
The minister folded his well-tended hands on his blotter.
And yet, according to the surgeon's report on you, the French sabre cut perilously close to your manhood. I wonder.
Saybrook maintained a mask of indifference.
Do you anticipate that the job will entail swiving one of the witnesses?
He paused for a fraction.
Or buggering the cook? Are you fond of boys, Lord Saybrook?
Countered Grantham.
Not unnaturally so,
he answered.
And women? Why do you ask? Let us just say that I am curious, replied the minister. And let us just say that I am not inclined to satisfy your curiosity. You are very clever, Lord Saybrook, but cleverness can sometimes lead a man into trouble. So can stupidity.
Appearing to tire of the cat-and-mouse word game, Saybrook regripped his cane.
If you wish to speak about the assignment, let us do so. Otherwise, I will return to my townhouse.
You have obviously read a thorough dossier on me, so I imagine you have already decided whether you think me fit for the job.
A written report can tell only so much about a man,
replied the minister.
I prefer to judge for myself before making a final decision.
Saybrook started to rise.
Please sit, Lord Saybrook.
Papers shuffled.
I have been told that you are, for lack of a better term, an expert in chocolate. Might I inquire how you came to be so?
An edge of sarcasm crept into his voice.
Assuming that I am not offending your delicate sensibilities with my questions. My Spanish grandmother passed on her knowledge to me,
replied Saybrook.
In Andalusia, she was renowned for her healing skills, as well as her cooking talents. Cooking?
Repeated Grantham, as he plucked a page from his notes and reread it.
Your grandmother was a countess. Is that not correct? Yes, but in Spain, high-born ladies have a different notion of what is and isn't beneath their station. Cuisine is not menial labor. It is an art, as is healing, said the Earl. She was interested in the medicinal properties of many foods and plants, including Theobroma cacao.
The minister frowned.
The Latin name for the tree that yields cacao beans, he explained. I studied botany at Oxford before joining the army. A strange combination. Not as strange as you might think, said Saybrook. The ancient Aztec soldiers used chocolate as a stimulant. I am not interested in a scientific lecture, snapped Grantham. What I want to know is this. In your learned opinion, could chocolate in and of itself have poisoned the Prince Regent?
No, replied Saybrook without hesitation.
If perchance the prince had an intolerance to the cacao fruit, he would have suffered an adverse reaction from drinking a beverage made from the beans. And according to my uncle, Prinny has enjoyed his morning chocolate for years.
True, mused the minister.
So who would you consider the prime suspect?
I do not yet know enough about the case to form an opinion.
Well, we don't have a great deal of time to ponder the question, Lord Saybrook.
Grantham steepled his well-tended fingers.
I assume Mr. Mellon has explained the situation?
The Earl inclined his head a fraction.
Next month, a secret delegation of our Eastern allies is due to arrive in London for talks on how to end this interminable war. Napoleon's counteroffensive in Spain may be losing ground, but he has rebuilt the army shattered by the retreat from Russia into a formidable force and has taken personal command of the troops. Once again, he is marching east, looking to crush any resistance to his domination of the continent. It's critical that England coordinates its efforts with those of Tsar Alexander, the Austrians, the Swedes, and the Prussians. However, the death of our nominal ruler would throw the alliance into disarray, interrupted Grantham. The result could be catastrophic. An English breakfast might soon consist of eau au champignon and café au lait, observed Saybrook.
The minister fixed him with a frigid stare.
There is likely an assassin on the loose, and rather than make clever quips about cuisine, I expect you to apprehend him before the Allied delegation arrives in England. Assuming I agree to take the assignment, reminded Saybrook softly.
Grantham's expression remained impassive, but clearly he was unused to having anyone refuse to bow to his authority.
Let me phrase it differently, Lord Saybrook. It would be a great service to the government if you could help us apprehend the miscreant and assure the Prime Minister that the threat has been eliminated,
he said with syrupy sweetness.
For a man of your reputed talents, it should prove a simple task. Your expertise in chocolate should allow you to quickly identify the poison tainting the wafers. From there you have only to ascertain who had access to the kitchen. He gave a dismissive wave. And voila!
You seem rather certain that the case won't be a hard nut to crack.
The cook is the logical suspect, but we need to know if he has any co-conspirators. I'm sure if you apply some heat to the fellow, you will get some quick answers.
Do you want a confession? Asked Saybrook.
Or do you want the truth? For in my experience, torture elicits not but what the prisoner thinks his tormentor wishes to hear. Torture is such an unpleasant word. I prefer to call it persuasion.
Grantham's lip curled ever so slightly.
Surely, Lord Saybrook, you would agree that to be an effective investigator, one must be persuasive, among other things, answered Saybrook. But should I undertake this assignment, I would have to have carte blanche from you to handle it as I see fit. There is an old adage about too many cooks spoiling the broth. That could be a recipe for disaster. You'll just have to trust my skills in the kitchen.
Grantham considered the request for several long moments before giving a curt nod.
Very well. It is in the best interest of the government to have an independent investigator handle the matter. The military men assigned to my department are too close to the Prince Regent. I would not want it said that their judgment was clouded by personal feelings.
He tugged on a small cord beneath his desk, and within seconds a young man opened the office door.
My lord, ask Major Crandall to join us, Jenkins, said the minister.
Without another word to Saybrook, he turned away and began flipping through a stack of papers set on the far corner of his desk.
Sir! The major marched in and clicked his heels. You wish to see me?
You will be in charge of briefing Lord Saybrook on the facts that have been gathered so far concerning the poisoning of the Prince Regent. Give him the background information on the other guests present that evening, on Lady Spencer's staff, anything he wants.
Shall I call a carriage and escort his lordship to Lady Spencer's townhouse?
Grantham answered with a thin-lipped smile.
That is entirely up to him. He demanded complete autonomy in this case, and given the circumstance, I felt I had no choice but to agree.
Crandall shot Saybrook a look that left little doubt where his loyalties lay.
You will soon discover, Crandall, that Lord Saybrook is a very unusual fellow.
The smile turned a touch malicious.
For one thing, he likes cooking, and... Oh, forgive me. I neglected to ask if you also enjoy... embroidery? Alas, no, responded Saybrook politely. The only sliver of sharpened steel I've ever wielded is a saber. Oh, and a stiletto.
He tapped a finger to his chin.
Come to think of it, though, I did embroider a rather distinctive design on a man's chest once. It was the words cowardly cur, spelled out in large capital letters, seeing as he liked to rough up women before forcing himself on them. I thought it only sporting to give the weaker sex fair warning.
He and Grantham locked eyes.
Neither one blinked.
It was Crandall who broke the tense silence with a cough.
Will that be all, my lord? Yes, yes.
A drawer clicked open.
On your way out, ask Jenkins to bring me the file on the Swedish ambassador's brothel visits. This way, Lord Saybrook, growled Crandall.
Slipping out from the stairwell, Arianna hurried down the dimly lit corridor and eased open the door to her employer's study. Lady Spencer was upstairs entertaining the Prince Regent as he dined on his midday meal. And despite the strict restrictions on the royal appetite, the interlude ought to last at least another hour, in and out. With the servants gathered for their own repasts, the chances of being caught seemed slim. It was worth the risk, she decided. At any moment, the military might return to begin holding her balls to the fire, metaphorically speaking. When it came to that, she had an idea of how to escape the heat, but she would hate to flee empty-handed. Hearing the crunch of gravel, Arianna ducked behind the draperies and watched as a guard dressed as a gardener marched past the window. Bloody hell! With disguises and deceptions running rampant, the situation bordered on pure farce. Her father, whose favourite Shakespeare play was As You Like It, would have roared with laughter at seeing his daughter tweak the noses of the authorities by playing a modern-day Rosalind. Her mouth gave an involuntary twitch. Aye, and it would be even more amusing were her life not dangling by a thread. Reminded of the danger in dallying, Arianna quickly crossed to the chinoise escritoire, set in the far corner of the room. Like its owner, the striking piece was designed to draw the eye. The exotic bamboo legs, twined with sinuous serpents, gleamed with gilded gold. In bold contrast, the ebony-trimmed drawers and writing surface were lacquered in a deep shade of vermilion. The colour of blood, thought Arianna, riffling through the sheets of scented stationery that lay in careless disarray beside the crystal inkwell. Finding them all blank, she moved on to the row of drawers, whose contents proved to be just as uninteresting. Moving on, she found only stubs of sealing wax and a vial of musky perfume in the last compartment. Damn, there must be something. Her employer's reputation for pursuing profligate pleasure was the reason she had spent weeks of manipulation to gain a position here. The pigeonholes were stuffed with various bills, most of them unpaid for some time, judging by the shrill tone of the shopkeepers. As she sorted through them, Arianna mentally reviewed what she knew about the mistress of the house. A buxom blonde widow of moderate means, Lady Spencer was no stranger to dalliances with rich men. The Prince Regent was her latest paramour, and by all accounts the affair had started 6 months ago, when the two of them had met during a week-long party at the Prince's Royal Pavilion in Brighton. Finished with the bills, Arianna paused, taking a moment to study the decorative strip of panelling above the drawers. Reopening the centre one, she pulled it out all the way and slid her hand into the opening, feeling for any ridge or groove hidden at the back. There were other darker rumours, too. Whispered hints about Lady Spencer's involvement with men far more debauched than Prinny. It was said that she had been introduced to the Royal Rake by several of his cronies from the Carlton House set, men who sought to use the royal connection for... Snick! The panelling sprung open, revealing two hidden compartments. The first one held a sheaf of folded letters tied with a length of red velvet, billets doux, by the look of them. Arianna thumbed through them, pausing over several from the same gentleman. After a slight hesitation, she slipped one of them into her sleeve before retying the ribbon and returning all the others to their original position. The second one contained an assortment of keys. Buried amid the jumble of wrought iron and silvery steel was a small drawstring pouch made of tan chamois. Inside were a handful of identical reddish gold medallions, engraved with an image and several lines of ornate script. Arianna tucked one in her pocket before returning the rest to the little bag. Intrigued by what she had found so far, Arianna spent a moment longer exploring the depths of the hidden compartment. Sure enough, there was something else there. Her fingers brushed over a slim pasteboard folder wedged against the grained wood. She fished it out and found it contained a sheaf of papers covered with mathematical equations. The top sheets appeared yellowed with age, while the ones beneath them seemed... Suddenly aware of the rustle of heavy silk in the corridor, Arianna hesitated, but curiosity won out over caution. No doubt it would prove useless, but the idea that Lady Spencer had a hidden interest in something besides men was too tantalizing to ignore. Stuffing the folder beneath her stomach padding, she quickly tidied up the telltale signs of her snooping, then spun away and took up a position by the marble mantelpiece.
"Why, Monsieur Alphonse, what a surprise to see you in the light of day." Lady Spencer paused in the doorway to smooth out her skirts. "Like a mushroom, you seem to favour dark places."
"Alors," replied Arianna,
casually replacing the Sèvres snuff box that she had been examining.
"Seeing as our little world has been turned topsy-turvy, I thought I had better come up and fetch the week's menus. You have not yet sent me your list, or have you lost your appetite for my cooking?"
Lady Spencer smiled, showing off a set of dimples. Arianna could understand the widow's appeal to the pleasure-loving Prince Regent. Everything about her had an earthy lushness, from her bulging bosom and rounded hips to her throaty purr, which oozed sensuality. As she moved closer, the air thickened with the honeyed scent of lilacs.
"No, monsieur, I vow I cannot imagine life without your gâteau au chocolat."
Fanning her cheek, she gave Arianna a wink. "Are you sure I can't seduce the recipe out of you?" For a moment, Arianna wondered how Lady Spencer would react if she were allowed to uncover the shocking truth, and then promptly decided that the prince's mistress might not be as horrified as she should be.
"Quite sure, madame,"
growled Arianna, retreating a step at the unwelcome thought of being invited to make up a royal ménage à trois. "What a pity. I adore plump men."
"Not when they haven't a feather to fly with, madame."
Arianna folded her arms across her goose-down stomach.
"I couldn't afford you, in more ways than one."
"True," agreed Lady Spencer, a note of regret shading her voice. "But you have a rather unique charm." Choking back the insane urge to laugh, Arianna dipped into a formal bow.
"The supper menu, madame?"
"Ah, yes, supper." Lady Spencer licked her lower lip. "Something simple, Monsieur Alphonse. After all you have been through lately, I don't want to put you to any further trouble." The carriage wheels spun through a sharp turn, the iron rims jolting over the cobblestones, as the driver urged the team to a quicker pace. Saybrook and his escort had exchanged few words since the Earl had agreed that a visit to Lady Spencer's townhouse should be the first order of business. However, the Major's displeasure was eloquent in his body language. He was sitting pressed against the far panels, creating as much space as possible between them, as if fearing that Saybrook's friction with Grantham might rub off on him.
"Tell me," asked the Earl slowly, "why wasn't the cook placed under arrest right away? Your superior seems sure he is the culprit." "As I've tried to explain, we did not wish to draw any undue attention to the incident," answered Crandall with a muttered sigh. "Lord Grantham wishes to handle the interrogations discreetly. So for the moment, no one will be taken into official custody. But be assured, the entire household staff is under strict orders not to leave the premises."
"You are not afraid that he might escape?"
"Let him try. Naturally, we have men watching the place to ensure that no one slips away."
The Major smoothed a thumb over his moustache.
"Personally, I should not be surprised if he attempted to flee. There is something very havy-cavy about the fellow.
How so? Inquired Saybrook.
To begin with, he is French.
So are most of the chefs who serve the temps, he observed.
I wouldn't know, replied Crandall stiffly.
The rest of the ride proceeded in rigid silence. Saybrook stepped down awkwardly from the carriage, his cane catching in the iron rung of the bottom step. The major watched the Earl stumbling with an ill-concealed smirk.
If you'll follow me, Lord Saybrook, I shall show you the way to...
Actually, that won't be necessary.
The smirk slid from Crandall's face.
I prefer to conduct my inquiries alone. In my experience, people are more apt to speak freely when they aren't surrounded by strangers.
I don't think that's a good idea, argued the Major.
Perhaps not. However, you heard Lord Grantham. He has given me the authority to do as I see fit.
He held out his hand.
I shall keep the files on the staff and the guests, if you please.
Crandall passed over the document case, although he looked none too happy about it.
Thank you for your briefing. If I have any other questions, I know where to find you.
An angry flush of red mottled the Major's cheeks at the unexpected dismissal.
Would you care to keep the carriage? He asked through gritted teeth.
No, I would rather you take it.
Saybrook glanced up and down the quiet street.
As you so kindly pointed out, the less attention we draw to the place, the better.
Turning on his heel, Crandall stalked back to the waiting vehicle. In response to several sharp raps of the knocker, the heavy oak-panelled front door opened a crack, and a pair of wary eyes fixed the Earl with a basilisk stare.
If you are soliciting money for a wounded war veteran's fund, we cannot help you, sirrah. The lady of the house cannot be disturbed.
I'm not here about money, said
Saybrook, smiling slightly as he shrugged his bony shoulders.
As for Lady Spencer, I'm afraid that I'll have to trespass on her hospitality, he added. I've come from Whitehall.
The butler stepped back and allowed him to enter the townhouse.
If you would wait in the drawing room, sir.
A wave of a white-gloved hand indicated a pleasant, light-filled room to his right.
I will fetch her ladyship.
Saybrook shuffled over the brightly coloured carpet, eyeing the jade dragons on the mantel and bright silk pillows embroidered with unicorns nestled on the window seat. Next to it, a pair of faux gold monkeys danced atop a brass tea chest.
Do you like my menagerie, sir?
Saybrook turned from his study of an alabaster lion.
You have collected quite a kingdom of wild animals, he answered slowly, including the king of the jungle.
Her laugh was low and sultry, making her sound as if she had just tumbled out of bed.
Thank God that someone from Whitehall actually has a sense of humour. You cannot imagine how tedious that stiff-rumpled Major Crandall has been this last week, glowering at me and my staff like we were a vile plague about to infect his private parts.
Saybrook nodded gravely, though a tiny twitch did seem to play at the corners of his mouth.
I confess that I'm also included on his list of noxious diseases.
I'm delighted to hear it, she said cheerfully. May I offer you some refreshment? Tea? Sherry? Or something stronger, so that we may toast to the prospect of his phallus falling off in the near future.
Thank you, but no. Though I do second your sentiment, she smiled. As you can guess, this is not...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.